Well, it's a real pleasure to introduce Tyler Harlan today, and it was a nice serendipitous series of events, I think, that brought you to us to talk today. And so I'm looking forward to this. Tyler is currently a postdoctoral fellow in sustainability at the Atkinson Center for a Sustainable Future, and also at the Department of Development Sociology at Cornell University. So just to kind of, and I'm sure Tyler will probably talk about this in broader terms, but I mean, we're at this kind of moment where everybody has ironically been increasingly looking towards China, of all places, to kind of become a new alternative or a model for green development, for green infrastructures, for those kinds of things. And I think Tyler's work is really kind of comes at a really kind of critical juncture where we need to be kind of thinking much more critically about what that means in the context of China's broader development processes, but also in the context of China's role in more global green development patterns, which I think is also the subject of upcoming work that Tyler's going to be doing.
Yeah, thanks everybody for coming. We're a small group, so this is good, and hopefully we'll have a few questions afterwards. And thanks also to the Center for Asian Studies for putting on the talk, and Tim for reaching out. And it was a nice series of events that allowed me to be here today. So in my talk today, I'm going to explore how communities and environments in Western China are transformed through the state's pursuit of renewable energy and green development, as Tim was saying, and in the process are remade as a frontier. But more than that, I'm going to analyze the role of the frontier in shaping renewable energy expansion, and by extension, the trajectory of China's green development. So let me give a quick outline of what to expect. I'll first set the stage by giving an overview of China's renewable energy boom and the case of small hydropower, or SHP, or small hydro, which is China's most widespread renewable energy technology. I'll then situate small hydro and renewable energy within an analytical framework that I'm calling the low carbon frontier from the title of the talk. And I'll follow with a brief description of my research process, field sites and methods, before focusing on one section of my research in number four on how and why SHP policy has changed over time and space. And I'll examine this both at the national level with national policy shifts, and also the ways that SHP developed regionally in China as a result of those national policies. Let's get started. In the last decade, China has built renewable energy installations at a rate matched nowhere else in the world, and now boasts 15% of all systems installed worldwide. In the wake of US withdrawal from the Paris Climate Agreement last year, President Xi Jinping declared China's intent to lead the world in renewable energy, with plans to spend $360 billion between 2017 and 2020. Despite these investments, though, as we know, China's economy is still largely comprised of energy-intensive manufacturing, creating toxic levels of air, soil, and water pollution, not to mention 29% of the world's greenhouse gas emissions in 2017. China's national pivot to renewable energy is therefore both an economic strategy and an environmental imperative for the country. It's the anchor of what China's most recent five-year plan and its first paragraph calls green development. Well, unbeknownst to many, the most popular renewable energy in China is not solar or wind, it's small hydropower. Small refers to the installed capacity of a plant or the amount of electricity it can produce under ideal conditions. There's no agreed upon definition of small in the world. In a lot of places, it's up to 10 megawatts. In China, it's up to 50 megawatts. As a comparison, the Three Gorges Dam installed capacity is about 22 gigawatts. Small hydro, along with biogas, was China's first ever renewable energy. The first plant was installed in 1911. And SHP is framed by the state as a tool of green development, both because it's renewable and because it has a history of providing electricity to households who don't have a power grid connection, which then replaces the need for those households to go out and cut down trees for firewood. So let me give a brief sense of how small hydro plants work. They're a little bit different than big dams like the Three Gorges. So 90% of small hydro plants in China don't actually have a dam. So instead, they look like this. This is called diversion type run of river. And a small weir is installed on the stream, upstream of the powerhouse down here. It diverts flow along this channel into a four-bay tank where the sediments can silt down. And then it goes down this penstock, which is pressurized into the powerhouse where it drives the turbines and back into the mainstream. You can have several plants on one river. When you do, it's called a cascade, just like with big dams. If you do have a cascade, then what generally happens is that the water coming out of the powerhouse goes straight into the channel for the next plant, and so on and so on. There are 6, 7, 8, 9 plants in a cascade in many parts of China. So today, there are more than 47,000 small hydro plants in China, with a combined installed capacity of about 74 gigawatts, or about 4 times the installed capacity of the Three Gorges. This is just over 4%, as we can see in the green, of China's total installed capacity, and was only overtaken by wind energy 2 years ago. Wind is now at 9%. But if we were to look at the same chart 10 years ago, small hydro would make up basically 100% of China's renewable energy installed capacity. And that's because large hydro in the red is not considered renewable energy in China in the same way that small hydro, wind, and solar are. It's sort of its own different beast. So internationally, China has installed more plants than any other country, far more than any other country. And China is seen as a world leader in small hydropower. Chinese officials and companies actively promote their experience and technology as a model of green development, a model that other countries can learn from. Chinese small hydro enterprises are also investing and constructing plants in other countries from South Asia to Africa, as we can see in this map of Chinese commercial engagements in small hydro all over the world. Commercial engagements refers to investment, construction services, and also the sale of equipment. But oddly, while Chinese officials promote small hydro internationally, the government is restricting it domestically. Last year, the provincial governments of Yunnan and Sichuan provinces, which have the first and second most installed SHP capacity in China, announced an immediate halt to all new SHP construction. A few years later, the National 13th Five-Year Plan for Energy included almost no new funding for SHP, and the funding that was included was earmarked for refurbishing existing plants, not for new ones. Paradoxically, the stated reason for these changes is that SHP is ecologically destructive and a barrier to green. These policies were enacted even though large hydropower plants continue to be built, despite the fact that they are way more ecologically destructive than SHP. So what's going on here? Why is the Chinese government restricting its own small hydro industry, internationally renowned small hydro industry? Well, there's a fairly common explanation for these new restrictions on small hydro, which is that SHP was developed in a disorderly way by local governments and private investors, and that they did so because they prioritized revenues and profit over environmental protection, leading them to build plants without regard for their social and environmental impacts. This is a fairly common refrain in studies of Chinese policy implementation. Implementation, putting economics before the environment, dried up streams and negatively affected aquatic and riparian ecology, which we can see in this photo here. Again, this is a fairly common explanation because it places the blame at the local level, not at the national level. Basically, this is a response to the question, why did small hydropower fail, or why did it go off the rails? But I think this is the wrong explanation, or at least it's insufficient. Placing blame solely on local officials and investors ignores the motivations and incentives that shape their decisions, which can't just be explained as putting revenues and profit ahead of the environment. And this explanation also overlooks the changing role of small hydro in local and national green development, which has shifted from an off-grid energy source for conservation and rural development in remote areas by replacing firewood collection to an engine of low-carbon industrial development for China's booming cities. So instead of asking why small hydro failed, what we need to ask is what small hydro is meant to do for the state in different times and places. That is, we need to understand the broader political and economic geography in which small hydro is situated. And as I'll show in this talk, the reason that SHP has been restricted is because it's now seen as inefficient at extracting low carbon value for urban consumers and the national government. By low carbon value, I just mean the political and economic value that's assigned to resources that are low carbon, like renewable energy. Resources that need to be extracted from specific places like frontiers, far from the cities that consume it. Okay, so before we dig into the details of the case, I want to place small hydro in the broader context of the political economy of China's green development and green development in general, which I'm going to lay out in the analytical framework of the low carbon frontier. Okay, well, unsurprisingly, there's a vast scholarly and policy literature on the political economy of China's green development, which is mainly focused on policies and actions at national or regional scales, particularly in urban areas like the Tianjin-Binhai eco-city that we see here. Tim and I were talking about this yesterday. And this focus, you know, it makes sense. Policies are issued and progress is measured at the national scale, and cities are hotbeds of green technologies and policy innovation. And even if we look beyond China, the social science literature on the political economy of green development is similarly focused on nations and cities, especially those in the global north. And this work offers some important insights. But largely ingrained in these studies is an understanding of green development as a process of low carbon transition, which entails the eventual replacement of fossil fuels with renewable energy. And that within a national territory, that differences in economic and environmental outcomes are really about policy design and implementation. That is, that all places are on the same transition pathway, they're just getting there in different ways and at different speeds. But as a geographer, I think this view of green development as low carbon transition is incomplete, that it leaves out the intrinsic spatial inequality of balancing environmental protection with economic development. And here I draw on more than a decade of geography scholarship that connects low carbon transition in one location or scale to impacts in another location or scale, such as work tracing carbon offsets issued in cities in the global north to land enclosures and confiscation in rural areas and resource frontiers in the global south. What I suggest in this research is that these resource frontiers need to be at the center of analysis of green development and low carbon transition. That more than places where emissions can be offset, they're also integral producers of energy and raw materials for the green low carbon economy, especially renewable energy. So this is a major aim of this research project, to analyze the frontier of green development through the lens of energy systems. And I aim to place the many green innovations and environmental improvements that we see in cities within a broader geography, to untangle the web of connections between places that use renewable energy and the places that consume it, and to push back against the notion that renewable energy will benefit all places and communities equally by exposing the long-standing unequal geographical relationships that, that shape energy production and access and consumption, and the ways that states and firms deploy renewable energy and other green development schemes to achieve their own political and economic goals, whether those goals are green or not, or that may be green in some places but not in others. So given the global push to deploy renewable energy for green development, a process, as Tim said, seemingly led now by China, it's imperative to grasp how specific policies, technologies, and logics of green development become hegemonic and the spatial inequalities and social and environmental impacts that they produce. So, to capture these dynamics, I want to propose the overall framework of the low carbon frontier. What do I mean by this? Well, I use it to refer to both the discursive and the material construction of spaces as untapped stores of low carbon value, and the dynamics of locating and extracting this low carbon value through renewable energy infrastructure and other activities that are part of the low carbon economy. Activities which in their early stages are often rapid and uncoordinated with little state regulation, and that also supplant or reformulate existing economic and environmental strategies towards different ends. And also in using the word frontier, I highlight the long-held framing of resource-rich regions as unpopulated and backward, and the history of resource extraction and dispossession that this framing and state policy have enabled. State policy that often encourages resource extraction while being slow to regulate. And finally, I use the framework to highlight the boom and bust nature of resource extraction, whether those resources are low carbon or not, which include familiar dynamics of small-scale operations, overcapacity, devaluation, and consolidation, which are highly susceptible to global changes in commodity markets. In a broader sense, I think the low carbon frontier is useful, at least for me, because it shows low carbon transition to be a political and economic project that's innately geographical, which helps us to better understand the frontier of green development, the aim of this project. So in China, the vast majority of renewable energy installations are in a region known as Western China, which we could also include officially Inner Mongolia here. Western China looms large in the national consciousness as a land of vast mountains and deserts, unruly ethnic minority groups, and natural resource wealth. It's long been viewed in Chinese society as an economically backward and ecologically degraded frontier in need of development through state intervention. And it's thus been subject to a series of green development projects since the late 1990s, from rural electrification programs to reforestation to investments in energy infrastructure like SHP. By situating small hydro in the context of the frontier, we can better understand why it's been recently restricted, even as large hydropower plants continue to be built. This is because the change in the purpose of small hydro, which I mentioned earlier, from conservation and rural development to low carbon urban development, is intimately tied to state logics for green development interventions on the frontier, which has shifted from the frontier as a backward region in need of state intervention to a resource-rich region supplying renewable energy for the green economy. And this is the geographical relationship, I think, that will help us explain China's small hydro restrictions, but I think is also useful for studies of the political economy of green development in general. How did I investigate why small hydro was suddenly restricted while also being promoted to other countries and large hydro plants continue to be built? Well, this problem is actually kind of divided into three phases. There's a policy phase, an implementation phase, and an export phase. And that's because small hydro is kind of also a mobile policy and technology that has a different purpose and different manifestations in different times and places. So to capture this, I divided the actual research project also into three sections to correspond with these three phases. So the first section on small hydro policy is what I'm going to talk about for most of the rest of this presentation. In this section, I asked how and why did small hydro policy in China change over time and space, which required a close reading of policy and an attention to regional geographic trends of SHP development across China. So the second section on implementation, which I'll just kind of touch on, asked how profit motivations and political incentives shape the operation of plants on the ground, and also the impacts of SHP on farmers' electricity use, fuel wood collection, which I don't list there, and water access, particularly irrigation water access. And finally, the third section asked about the technologies, policies, and ideas of green development that are being exported from China to other countries, which linked small hydro expansion and contraction on the frontier, again, what I'll mostly be talking about today, to China's growing influence in the global green economy, which is a transition to my next project that I'll briefly mention. So to gather data for this research, I conducted a year of fieldwork across seven sites in China in three different provinces. So this map shows those provinces, well, really kind of cities and provinces. So the first is Beijing, where renewable energy policy is developed, to Yunnan province in western China, and then finally to Zhejiang province in eastern China, which is where China's first small hydro plants and government research institutes around small hydro are located. So I used four methods in this project. The first, analysis of policies, news articles, Chinese academic papers, document analysis, interviews with government officials, small hydro investors, resource managers, and farmers at different scales, household level survey, and also participant observation in international training programs and conferences. So for the rest of this talk, I'm just gonna, again, focus on the first section of the project, which asks how and why small hydro policy in China changed over time and space, which I think will get at that question that I was asking in the beginning about why small hydro has been restricted. So to answer this question, I'll trace China's small hydro policy over the last several decades and tie it to state logics for green development interventions in Western China. And remembering our framing of the low-carbon frontier, I'll also connect these policies to SHP development at the regional level. And this helps us to understand how the development of SHP feeds back into policy and ultimately to how the low-carbon frontier shapes China's broader green development trajectory. So just before we do that, let me give a brief description of Yunnan and Zhejiang, those two provinces I showed on the map. This is where I conducted on-the-ground fieldwork for this specific project. So this is Yunnan here. This is actually the New River Valley, way up in northwest Yunnan. And it's fairly typical of that area of Yunnan. So Yunnan is in western China. It's mountainous and water-rich. It's got one of the world's highest concentrations of biodiversity, as well as a high degree of ethnic diversity. its economy, like much of Western China, is based on agriculture, mineral extraction and processing, and energy generation, and also more and more tourism. Yunnan has about 11 gigawatts, or 15% of China's installed SHP capacity. Zhejiang province on China's east coast, and this is fairly typical seen in rural Zhejiang, is also mountainous and water rich. But unlike Yunnan, Zhejiang is more ethnically homogenous and has a highly diversified industrial economy. Zhejiang has about 4 gigawatts, or about 5% of China's installed SHP capacity. So Zhejiang is the control region for this section of the research because it developed SHP a lot earlier than Yunnan, and it's not subject to the same restrictions today. So those restrictions are really in Yunnan and Sichuan. So I selected three prefectures. Some of them are known as prefecture-level cities. I just say prefectures to make it easier. Three prefectures in Yunnan and one in Zhejiang as case studies for this research. In Yunnan, these are Yuxi. At Kunming, the capital is here, so Yuxi is fairly close to the capital. Wenshan and Nujiang, which is where that photo is from, and it's the furthest away from the capital, the most remote. The further away you get from the capital, the less economically diversified the prefecture you are. And in Zhejiang, I chose Lishui down here, which was the first region in China to rapidly develop small hydro. Okay, so how did SHP policies change and why? Well, as I mentioned briefly before, small hydro began as a way to provide electricity for villages that did not have a grid connection. Up through the 1980s, plants were very small and low voltage, and they were not connected to the national grid. Sometimes they were connected to any grid, sometimes they were connected to each other in a rural grid, and sometimes they would be connected to bigger and bigger grids, but not the national. They were approved and managed by local governments and subsidized through central government transfers and tax breaks. And in some cases, local villagers were actually able to obtain shares in the plant, and this is in the 1960s and 70s, and then they were paid a portion of the revenues, which village committees would then invest in new plants. And at this time, you know, China was still very poor, and small hydro plants were pretty evenly distributed across space. As we can see in this map of rural electrification counties that received subsidies for SHP in the 1980s and 90s. So all of our case study prefectures have counties that were included in this program. And also, what this basically says is that SHP was synonymous with rural electrification. Our rural electrification county meant an SHP county. That was the technology that they used. In the early 1990s, however, China's leaders began to adopt the language of green development and to talk openly about the need to reconcile economic growth in the environment. But as is clear from documents at the time, the state believed that poverty alleviation and economic growth needed to be solved first before environmental protection. And given that Western China has long been seen as economically backward, this view meant that it would be the target of green development interventions, which included massive investment in large-scale infrastructure for energy and mineral extraction, coupled with subsidies for forest protection and regeneration. Small hydro was included in these latter initiatives through a program called Small Hydro Replace Fuel Wood that was launched in 2001, which aimed to prevent deforestation in Western China, including our three case study prefectures in Yunnan. So we can think of these programs as based on a state logic of developing the frontier, of bringing it under state control and preserving its environment so that economic growth can continue in urban areas. Around the same time, however, Lishui in Zhejiang, our case study prefecture in Zhejiang, was experiencing a wave of small hydro construction, which was a response to central government policy that allowed a little bit of private investment in SHP for the first time. But these plants were a little bit different. They were in areas that already had grid connections. And the reason for this was that the central government saw SHP as a way to meet electricity needs in nearby eastern cities. So Zhejiang's grid infrastructure as well was a lot better than Yunnan's. It still is, and it was at the time as well. This graph here compares SHP installed capacity in Zhejiang, which is in the orange, and Yunnan, which is in the green, up to about 2002. So 95 to 2002. 95 is when the first data is available. This is kind of hard to show visually, even in a graph like this, but I want to stress again that Zhejiang is a lot smaller than Yunnan. It's about a third smaller in land area. It's a lot more urbanized, and it's got a far less exploitable water resources. And you can see both of them are pretty much tracking together, just like we saw on that map of rural electrification counties. It's fairly well distributed across space. But if we look at the trajectory since 2002, Yunnan and the green explodes while Zhejiang levels off. And the rest of Southwest China also exploded in small hydro installed capacity, which we can see here, basically a tripling of installed capacity in just about a decade. We can see the same boom in map form here. This is a little bit busy, but I just want to point out a couple of provinces. This is Yunnan here, and this is Sichuan. Remember, number one and number two in SHP installed capacity in China. And this is installed capacity in 2000 versus 2015. So just a huge jump in Western China. We also saw growth in Zhejiang here, but not nearly as much. And now it's got a lot less than Yunnan. So what happened? What caused this? Well, in the early 2000s, the focus of state-led green development began to broaden to climate change mitigation and low-carbon industrial transformation. And the country's economy was also growing rapidly. So in 2002, which was where that graph shifted, the state enacted a set of electricity sector reforms that separated transmission from production, which also had the effect of generating grid investment in Yunnan. In 2003, the Yunnan government issued a policy encouraging the rapid growth of small hydro because it's green, and it's a model of green development. Private investors from Zhejiang province, and in fact, a lot of them from Lishui Prefecture, went to Yunnan to build new plants. In 2006, the Chinese state enacted the Renewable Energy Law, the first renewable energy law, followed by regulations forcing small hydro plants to connect to the grid and for grid operators to purchase their electricity. So here we're talking about a different state logic, a logic of extracting low carbon value for the state, which has had the effect of remaking Yunnan into a low carbon frontier. So let's dig a little bit deeper into the reasons for this SHP boom at the regional level. Just talked about the national level, let's go down to the regional. Why did it become so popular in Yunnan specifically? Well, small hydro was a far more mature technology than other renewable energy systems in the early and mid-2000s. Local governments already owned some, and private investors from Zhejiang and adjacent Fujian, just to the south of Zhejiang, wanted to build more. Local governments could also offer an attractive feed-in tariff for new plants, and investors can earn back their outlay in about 8 years, which was considered a good investment. Local governments could also speed through applications for river use rights and various preliminary studies like site selection, environmental impact assessment, and so forth. Finance was also pretty straightforward because investors could obtain loans from local commercial banks that had had success in lending to SHP projects in the past and were willing to do so again. Moreover, investors could obtain additional finance from the Clean Development Mechanism under the Kyoto Protocol, which is to basically provide finance from Annex 1, Global North countries to Global South countries, to do things like build renewable energy installations. And actually, China received more CDM funding than any other country, and it boasts 2/3 of all CDM small hydro projects. And Yunnan has 16% of all small hydro projects in the CDM. 16% of all of them in the CDM are in Yunnan. So I want to stress here that it's not as if a switch was just suddenly clicked and that small hydro was just all of a sudden low carbon. This was a bit more gradual than that. There was a growing realization that SHP could be repurposed as a renewable energy and that money could be made. Okay, so we know why private investors headed to Yunnan to construct small hydro plants, but what about local governments? Why were they so gung-ho about SHP beyond kind of national policies that encouraged them to do that? Well, I found that governments in all three of our case study prefectures in Yunnan saw SHP as a foundation for local industrial development. All three prefectures, but especially Wenshan and Nujiang, which are a little bit further away from Kunming, had economies that were based almost solely on resource extraction and agriculture. They still do. And small hydro offered a way to provide constant cheap electricity for new industries, electricity that did not have to be imported from outside of the prefecture. They could produce it for themselves. And since these prefectures are rich in resources, especially silicon, aluminum, and zinc, local governments concentrated on attracting investment in small mines and mineral processing facilities. In all three prefectures, but again, mostly in Wenshan and Nujiang, instituted a local policy of jointly developing mining and mineral processing with SHP. And they exported the rest of their electricity outside the prefecture and were able to make some money that way. So all of these local governments earned significant revenues from the taxes on SHP plants and on the export of electricity that I just mentioned. And there were several counties, kind of just one level down in administrative structure within these prefectures, that basically built their county economy solely on SHP. So here's a photo of one of these mineral processing facilities in Nujiang, taken by a colleague of mine, which we've argued in a paper in Global Environmental Change has led to localized deforestation in some areas of Nujiang and other prefectures in Yunnan due to the need to produce charcoal to use for smelting. So this is the exact problem that SHP was meant to solve, deforestation, and now it's causing it. So it's this combination of national policy changes and regional scale reactions that resulted in an overdevelopment of SHP in Yunnan, which I define as a rapid, uncoordinated increase in the size, the number, and the operating hours of SHP in a location where there's either insufficient electricity demand or more suitable energy alternatives to SHP, which has had the effect of reducing irrigation water access for farmers, forcing them to change the crops that they grow. It's also dewatered stream channels, so basically taking a lot of water out of the stream, putting it in the canal, and it's done that below the legal limit of 10% of average annual flow in the dry season, which means they're basically completely dried out. So not only did the overdevelopment of SHP produce those local impacts, it also generated far more electricity than the local economy or transmission infrastructure could handle. And this was particularly a problem in the wet season when electricity exports would face transmission bottlenecks, which we can see in this busy map of transmission infrastructure in Yunnan, which shows the lack of connectivity in a couple of our prefectures. So let's focus, this is Yuxi here. We can see it's pretty well connected, which means they don't really face transmission bottlenecks. Wenshan here has a direct ultra high voltage transmission line to Guangdong, but not really good connections to the rest of the province. Nujiang is up here. It's got basically no high voltage connections, and it's a north-south valley, so anything that's generated up here has to go all the way down here and then out. And so there are huge bottlenecks, especially in Wenshan and Nujiang, meaning that they just can't get the electricity out. And also, the small-scale mining operations that developed with SHP, it turns out they're actually unreliable energy users because they're both inefficient and they're subject to fluctuating commodity prices. The reason they were brought in is because they were thought to be these anchor users that would use electricity 24/7. Turns out they're not very good at that. So in an interview that I had with an employee of the China Southern Power Group, which operates this infrastructure, he called small hydro garbage electricity because so much is wasted in the wet season. And it's this wastage and inefficiency that's the primary concern of policymakers in Beijing, not the environmental impacts of SHP at the local level. So this explains why large hydropower plants continue to be built, even though their impacts are a lot bigger than those of SHP. It's because it's not about the impacts at all. It's about the wastage and the inefficiency. Well, today the small hydro boom has passed. So as I mentioned before, the provincial governments of Yunnan and Sichuan are restricting all further small hydro construction. And these specific policies weren't even really that necessary because investors that I spoke to in the last couple of years, well, they said they couldn't make a profit with small hydro anymore because the provincial government had kept reducing its feed-in tariff, basically the amount of money you make per kilowatt hour sold to the grid. But the provincial government's heavily subsidizing the feed-in tariff for solar and wind, the new popular renewable energies. And while, again, the stated explanation for these restrictions is that SHP is ecologically destructive at the local level, the real reason is that the government sees small hydro plants as inefficient producers of renewable energy. To the state, SHP was useful in the 1990s to drive conservation and rural electrification based on a logic of developing the frontier and bringing it under state control. But judged by a different logic of extracting low carbon value for cities, well, SHP in Yunnan fails, especially when compared to solar and wind and large hydropower, leading to a bust of SHP in Yunnan that saddles local governments and investors with devalued infrastructure. So, to conclude, let's return to that original problem that the Chinese government is restricting its renowned SHP industry. Well, we can see that the purpose of small hydro in China shifted from rural development and conservation to renewable energy, a renewable energy source for urban low-carbon industrial transformation. Small hydro was the first technology to really take advantage of state policy that subsidized renewable energy expansion. But as solar and wind have become cheaper, small hydro faces grid and transmission constraints, the government now sees small hydro, again, as a rationale for extracting low carbon value. In this talk, I propose the analytic of the low carbon frontier for thinking about the geographical dynamics at work in China's small hydro industry and the broader renewable energy sector. This concept highlights the discursive construction of resource-rich regions as stores of low carbon value that are ripe for investment, as well as state policies that encourage rapid scaling up of renewable energy technologies but often fail to regulate them. And you know, I think the low carbon frontiers also draws out that boom and bust nature of extractive energies in general, which I think we can add renewable energy. And the interactions and sometimes synergies that low carbon industries may have with carbon intensive industries like mining and mineral processing, reminding us that just because renewable energy is greener than fossil fuels doesn't automatically make it equitable or indeed environmentally sustainable. So as China continues along a green development trajectory, it's important to analyze how urban-centric low carbon transition shapes communities and environments on resource frontiers and vice versa. So what now? Well, the heyday of rapid SHP expansion in Western China is over. The industry is consolidating and small hydro investors are leaving if they can. Some big state owned enterprises are coming in and buying up those plants. Some of them are just being devalued altogether. This suggests kind of a closing of the low carbon frontier and an end to the boom and bust cycles that accompanied it. But Western China is also, as I kind of hinted at, experiencing a new, even bigger boom in solar and wind that I described at the beginning of the talk. Flush with state subsidies, renewable energy firms are turning new areas into low carbon frontiers with yet unknown benefits and consequences for communities and environments. A follow-up project to this paper will be to examine these new installations and their relationship to extractive industries, basically a symbiosis between the low and the high carbon frontier. But, and for my other project that I've been talking with Tim about, I'll be analyzing Chinese outbound renewable energy investment through the Belt and Road Initiative, which some of us might have heard about, to places where, like Yunnan in the 1990s and early 2000s, there's a huge amount of yet unexploited energy potential, a potential new low carbon frontier. So finally, let me end by saying I don't want this research to just be a kind of theoretical exercise about the frontier of green development. You know, small hydro was the first electricity source for tens of millions of rural people in China. It's still China's second largest renewable energy industry and technology. And as China's early experience showed, you know, renewable energy systems like SHP can have multiple environmental and economic benefits. We all know this. But these benefits are shaped by how, why, and where the technology is used, not the technology itself. Thanks. Well, they would if they built large hydro plants there, because large hydro plants make it worth it, because it's a big investment. But if it's just a bunch of smaller ones, and again, these smaller ones, a lot of them are 40, 45, 50 megawatts, and there are a lot in Yujiang. I think there's like 180 or something in the whole prefecture. Well, you would think that they might think about building some infrastructure to bring that electricity down, but they don't care about those plants. They care about large hydro, they care about solar and wind. And so they're building new ultra-high voltage transmission lines from new large hydropower plants from Inner Mongolia, where they're building lots of wind installations, from solar installations also in places like Qinghai, kind of western, northwestern China, where there's a lot of solar radiation. But the government is basically soured on small hydro because they don't think it's worth it. Yeah. I'm glad you brought that up, because there's actually a recent study from a couple of years ago that's from Nujiang that said that depending on the topography, if you have a cascade of small hydropower plants, the impacts can actually be bigger than one large hydropower plant that's dammed. Just because it's, if you think about like the New River Valley, the small hydropower plants aren't on that big trunk river itself. They're on the tributaries up here. So it basically diverts all the water in the tributaries, which actually impacts the large trunk stream to a great degree. And so there is this research out there that said, yes, small hydropower impacts are quite large. And so I don't want to say that that's not true. In fact, the government's sort of rhetoric that small hydropower plants cause ecological impacts, that's absolutely true. That's what I've seen in the field. And that's what I found with it also reducing water access for farmers. The point is, I guess, is that, well, large hydropower, as you said, has more, like produces more kilowatt hours of electricity. But when you build lots and lots of large hydropower, like China is going to do, hundreds of gigawatts of them, and you say nothing about the ecological impacts of those, but you restrict small hydro because of ecological impacts, I think that that's not actually what's happening. I guess I misspoke, not for industrial development. You're absolutely right. That was exactly the reason that it was used for. You know, for the smallest plants in the most remote areas were just used for rural electrification in the beginning. But then, as you said, I mean, there's for a long time been an actual policy of using it for small-scale manufacturing or to power government facilities or something like this. But for mining and mineral processing, these kind of energy-intensive anchor tenants for energy use, at this kind of small scale level where it's actually also fairly inefficient to mine and process minerals at a very small scale like that, that was unanticipated. National funds kind of slowed down and almost stopped in the 2000s because it was replaced by private investment. So the only way they can really build new plants is if they can attract private investors. And now that at the provincial level, but based on central level direction, they're reducing the feed-in tariff for small hydro in favor of solar and wind quite a lot less. Actually, I think at the moment in United is one-third. It doesn't make economic sense anymore, but it definitely did in the 2000s. That's right. Kind of as you say, there's a dispatching management of small hydro in Yunnan that happens, the China Southern Power Grid at its local and regional offices figures out, when plants are going to run at what kind of capacity at certain times, which ones are going to have to shut down for a little while, and also how much electricity there kind of is in one place, like in a prefecture, and how much can be exported via that one line somewhere else, generally to cities. There is that management, but the infrastructure is not up to scratch for dealing with the amount of small hydro plants that have been built in Yunnan over that period of time. And they're not going to invest in these new batteries and new fancy kind of smart grids. They're going to do that in Beijing and eastern China, not in Yunnan, at least not for small hydro. They'll build ultra-high voltage transmission lines for large hydro plants and large wind farms and solar facilities. In terms of large hydro displacing small hydro, well, the small hydro plants aren't going away. They are just being heavily curtailed during the wet season. And in Nujiang specifically, well, it's not that they'll build large hydropower plants in Nujiang, at least not right now. They might in the future. But it's just that Nujiang will cease to be a even semi-important electricity producer, a producer of renewable energy. It also doesn't have very much wind or solar kind of capacity, so it needs to turn its economy to something else. If you curtail a small hydro plant, it means that it doesn't mean that water can continue to flow through both turbines because it will short circuit the equipment. So it has to leave the canal by a spillway. And in these sort of mountainous areas, that spillway can handle a small volume of water at times, but when you're curtailing a plant and it's only generating at 60%, it means that all that water is coming down the spillway and causing massive soil erosion, which is what I saw all over these prefectures. So yes, it's fairly environmentally destructive to curtail, but there's nothing you can do. Yeah, so these conferences were in also in Zhejiang province, in the capital of Zhejiang, Hangzhou. There were two organizations that hosted them. One was called the National Center for Rural Electrification, and the other one's called the International Small Hydro Consortium. Both of those are kind of international institutes, but they're based in China and basically staffed wholly by Chinese nationals, and they have a parent ministry. So they run training programs, multiple training programs every year, in small hydropower, for officials, engineers, even investors actually from other countries. So I attended one for South and Southeast Asian attendees, and then one for ministerial attendees from all over the world, but they were mainly from Africa. And then they also hosted a conference or two just about small hydro and green development. I attended the conference as a kind of participant mainly, but I also had gotten to know everybody who worked in the institution, and so I would help with some sort of English translations here and there. I would actually help kind of direct participants for where they were supposed to go next. And generally could just hang out and talk to everybody, the Chinese nationals who did the training and also the participants. And so it was just kind of a nice 2 week, both of those were 2 weeks long. So it was just a nice sort of period that was really offered a lot of opportunities to chat and interview. It's low tech compared to the others. It's thought of as low tech now compared to the others. It used to be thought of as high tech because it was China's main renewable energy source. But it's more efficient per kind of kinetic turning kinetic energy into electrical energy, more efficient than solar PV panels or wind turbines at turning their respective energy sources into electrical energy. So it's actually, it's low tech, but it's more efficient. It just has pretty big environmental impacts, as we saw. I think there's definitely a discourse of using large-scale installations like solar and wind for economic development in a local and regional area. It's almost, because they're so big, it's almost more of a regional economic development argument than a local one that we found small hydro. We should be skeptical not only of the kind of benefits that might accrue to local people from big installations like that because they're producing energy for elsewhere, but also we should be skeptical of the fact that that'll drive economic development forever. Because there'll be technological innovation and those installations might well be replaced not long afterwards. Are they trying to spread it around? I think so they are to an extent, but they're also hampered by where the resources are actually located.
All right, well, thank you once again. It's a great talk, great questions, really provocative stuff. Thanks so much.
Thanks, sir.